Good morning, everybody. My name is Jackie Terraza. I'm the Carolyn Mussey Director here at the Colby College Museum of Art, and it is such a pleasure to welcome you today to a very, very, just an exciting exhibition and what will be a wonderful conversation to get us started. And a few of you, I think, were able to peek at the exhibition. There will be time to look at it afterwards and also refreshments in our Adams Gallery, and a few people will be coming in, but let's get started. I want to, you know, I think it's especially given the fact that we're focusing on the work of Alex Katz, it's good to begin with where we are. And we are, very specifically, we're right now at Colby College. We are here in Waterville, we are here in Maine, we are in the homelands of the Wabanaki people. And I mention place because for 70 years, Maine has been such an important part of Alex Katz's work. And it's not by coincidence that here we are at Colby College celebrating an exhibition, a really important exhibition of Alex's work, because those decades ago, he went to Skowhegan early on, in one of the early classes of the Skowhegan School of Painting and Sculpture, which was only about half an hour away. And because of that, a relationship was formed between the then director, Hugh Gordley, and Alex, and others who were involved with Skowhegan and who were involved with the museum. And long story short, then, as many of you know, a number of years later, in the early 90s, Alex took the bold step of entrusting the Colby College Museum of Art with a collection, a significant collection of his works and his archive starting at that time. A collection that has grown and that is truly an honor and a responsibility to steward, and we are so grateful to you. I can't think of an artist or a museum that have been most transformed, an academic museum that has been transformed as you have transformed the Colby College Museum of Art. It's truly exceptional. Many museums have estates of artists, but to have an active relationship with a living artist in the way that we have with you is quite something. So I'll offer brief remarks and many things, and then turn things over to the person here to my left, Levi Prombaum, who is our Katz consulting curator, a title that a colleague in the field recently said, like, there is not a cooler title to have in the field than to be the Katz curator, and it's somebody I really respect. Levi joined us this spring. He succeeds Diana Tweet, who was the former Katz curator of modern and contemporary art. And Diana was an early organizer of the exhibition that we celebrate today, Alex Katz, Theater and Dance. Levi is a curator and an art historian, and he had the distinction of being appointed to the 2021 American Council of Learned Societies Leading Edge Fellow at Mass MoCA, and of spending the last year turning his dissertation on mid-century portraiture into a book with support from the Getty Foundation, which, as you know, is quite a distinction. He is also, importantly, an assistant editor and a contributor to the exhibition catalog of the retrospective that will open at the Guggenheim this October, and which I hope many of you also get a chance to see, and to which we are lending a significant number of works. So I've been anticipating this day for many, many months, and in part because the experience of being involved with this exhibition and the book, which you will have a chance to purchase if you'd like at the lobby. We're waiting for the shipment of all of the works, but as you can tell, it's quite a fun and wonderful book. This has really opened up my way of thinking about not only Alex Katz's work, but also about art. In ways that I just didn't expect. And in some ways, it goes back to my first encounter with Alex Katz's work, which was really as an undergraduate painting student. You know, Alex was one of those artists who you knew if at that time, this was the late 80s, you knew his work because he was one of those famous artists. And I admire the work because I was making figurative painting, but what I didn't understand at the time was how the flatness that I perceived in the work, in terms of the stylistic flatness of the work, actually encompass an entirely performative dimension. And if you think about it, a lot of his figurative works, if you know the work well, a lot of his figurative works feature people standing or sitting, or they may appear quite still, and yet they're always in relation to each other or in relation to a social environment or some other kind of environment. There's always a sense of kind of movement and performance in the work. And I hope that in the experience of today's exhibition for you, that you perhaps also have some kind of shift in perspective, because really that is what certainly for me is true, and for many of you may be true, of seeing art allows for those kinds of shifts in understanding and perspective, which is exactly what we do here at the Colby College Museum of Art. We open new ways of thinking, new ways of understanding art, and we serve as a forum for dialogue, for connection, for inquiry, and for creativity. So Alex Katz Theater and Dance is the first comprehensive museum presentation of the artist Alex Katz, highly collaborative and playful work with choreographers, with dancers, with theater people, with playwrights, and really a very experimental group of people that he's been working with and in relation to for a long time. And it brings to life the profound interconnection between the visual and the performing arts that has really been true, certainly since the early part of the 20th century, but really especially since the mid-20th century and certainly into today. I think a story that also needs to be better understood, just as the story that you will see today of Alex Katz's relationship to theater and dance needs to be better understood. And that, again, is something that we do so well here at the Colby Museum. We research and open access to those stories that have not yet been fully told or fully heard. So I can't wait for you to experience the exhibition and the book, and to really feel for yourself the playful audacity of a lot of the work and of the practice. Collaboration has been the word, and I guess that's appropriate for a show that relates to theater and dance. And first, I want to note the kind of collaboration that has happened in relation to the archival research that was necessary for the show, the conversations, the partnership with Alex Katz, with the Katz Studio, with Paul Taylor Dance Company, and with those who have played a crucial role in the production of so many of the works that are featured in the exhibition and the catalog. So thank you to Alex, to all of the collaborators for being part of that process. I'm also super grateful to Vincent Katz and to Vivian Biddenkirk Katz, who have championed this project and have been just extraordinarily helpful throughout. And Vincent, you're here. Vivian is in Brazil, but here in spirit. The Katz studio archivist, Dorinka Chase, has been unbelievable, as well as Juan Gomez, who is essential as the lead studio assistant for Alex Katz. Michael Novak, who you'll hear from today, as well as the staff of Paul Taylor Dance Company, and especially Noah Aberlin, mm-hmm. have been exceptional as well, truly lending their support, their knowledge, surfacing studies and props and all kinds of things that we were not aware of when we started the project and that you'll see in the exhibition. And in fact, along with others, Paul Taylor Dance Company is the major lender in addition to the Katz Studio. And their materials are complemented by loans from Ropac, from Peter Bloom Gallery, from Gladstone Gallery, from the Milwaukee Museum of Art, and from private collectors. I mentioned Diana Sweet earlier, who provided the crucial initial curatorial research support and leadership of the project, including selecting the contributors for the publication. And the catalog was developed and produced in collaboration between Alex and his studio, editor Lauren Olson from Rizzoli Electra, who published the book, and the designer Sacco, which, as you'll see, I mean, the book itself just brings this work to life like no other. I want to mention Megan Carey, who was instrumental in the publication itself. She is our Barbara Alphon Senior Manager of Exhibitions and Publications, and who has been also the brilliant orchestrator of so many facets of this exhibition, truly. She's over there. And the book includes the writing of multiple contributors, Jennifer Tipton, the lighting designer who collaborated with Alex Katz on a number of productions, the painter David Sally, and Paul Taylor's first manager, Charlie Reinhardt. We have been fortunate to work from and to learn from the artist, the critic, the curator, Rob Storr, who we'll also hear from today, and who has been pivotal in providing the conceptual and aesthetic and spatial guidance in terms of how really he laid out the show. And as you'll experience it, the way in which the show is laid out and the choices that he made in the process of figuring out what should be finally in the physical space of the exhibition is in itself an artwork, I think, in terms of really understanding profoundly what the work is about. Levi, partner with Rob Storr when the show was being laid out, and also authored the project's exhibition brochure, which you will have find a very handy thing as you go into the galleries. So thank you to Rob, and thank you to Levi for that work. I'm almost done. We have an exceptionally talented team here at the Colby Museum. In addition to Megan, I want to thank Beth Finch for her crucial curatorial guidance as the chief curator, and to highlight our collections and our installation teams, who in partnership with fabricators really did an outstanding job realizing this project in space. Annette Van Aken, Lorraine Delaney, Chris Patch, Paige Dorr, Nancy Bixler, David Holbrook, David Ross, Joanna Lundberg, Mark Nabrowski, and David Pinkham all worked on this exhibition. And everybody here at Colby also brings our exhibitions to life, from our administrative staff, our development staff, communications, security, engagement, as well as additional curatorial staff. We could not do all of this without good leadership, and I'm grateful for the leadership of President Green and also our Museum Board of Governors, who provide crucial trust and support in what we do. And last but absolutely not least, I want to express my gratitude to those who help fund this exhibition, specifically this project, and also those who have established endowments that allow us to continually launch into projects such as this one with confidence at the early stages of the work before we actually have a perspective that we can send to somebody. That crucial endowment support is quite important. The exhibition and the catalog are generously supported by Ed and Betsy Cohen. I'm grateful that you are here. By Thaddeus Ropak Gallery, and also by Brendan Dugnan. And finally, additional support is provided by the Barbara Alphon Fund for Exhibitions and Publications, the Merkin Family Publication Fund, and the 25th Anniversary Fund, and the Ed Turner Fund. So with that, my sincere thanks to all of you for being here and for all who made this exhibition. And now to you, Levi.
Thank you so much, Jackie, for that wonderful welcome, and thank you all for being here today. My name is Levi Prombaum. I'm the Katz Consulting Curator here at Colby, and I'm so honored to facilitate today's discussion between our extremely distinguished guests. I get to introduce them, and condensing all of your expertise and accomplishments into single paragraphs was impossible, so I apologize to all of you, but I'm going to try anyways, starting with our exhibitions curator, Rob Storr. Storr received his BA from Swarthmore College and an MFA from the School of the Art Institute of Chicago. He spent over a decade as a senior curator in the Department of Painting and Sculpture at MoMA in New York, where he organized major thematic and monographic exhibitions and coordinated MoMA's celebrated project series. After his time there, he served as professor of modern art at the Institute of Fine Arts at NYU, and then as dean of the Yale School of Arts, as well as a tenured professor in the Department of Painting and Printmaking at Yale, where he's a professor emeritus. Storr is widely regarded as one of our foremost critics of American art, with a prolific and sensitive and richly spirited body of writing to match, and he's been honored to name just a few distinctions by the International Association of Art Critics, by the Smithsonian Institution, and the French Ministry of Culture. He's also unreservedly among the best critics and curator of Alex's works. And so Rob, me and the rest of the Colby team, we're just so grateful for your vision and for all that you've done to shape this beautiful show. Welcome. We're also joined by Michael Novak, the second artistic director in the history of the Paul Taylor Dance Foundation, who was chosen by and succeeded Mr. Taylor himself. A critically acclaimed Taylor dancer from 2010 to 19, Novak has performed in 50 Taylor dances in all, as well as in several works by Taylor Commission choreographers. Under his direction, the Paul Taylor Dance Company offers a robust touring program, an ever-expanding repertory Taylor canon, as well as important historical masterpieces and commission works by 21st century choreographers. The New York Times hailed Novak's inaugural season as artistic director as groundbreaking and inspirational. And he has organized many, many impressive things, including the first presentation of all six of Paul Taylor's iconic dances set to music by Bach. He's launched a multi-year international touring retrospective of the Taylor repertoire, and he's continued to bring the company's performances to audiences across America throughout the pandemic. No easy feat, earning the designation Best of Dance 2021 from the Washington Post. Michael, thanks for all your support, and especially, we especially want to thank you for sharing the treasures of the Paul Taylor Dance Company.
Of course.
They are so, so beautiful. And I have the great privilege of introducing the artist himself, Alex Katz. He is an alumnus of Cooper Union and the Skowhegan School of Painting in Maine, and he is a hell of a great painter. His paintings, cutouts, drawings, and prints have been the subject of more than 250 solo exhibitions and nearly 500 group exhibitions internationally since the start of his career. Over the last seven decades, he's honed a singular idiom that belongs to the visual worlds of modern painting and modern American life that has a formal experimental nature that's as rigorous as it is virtuous, and who's transformed numerous artistic traditions through a commitment and profound attunement to the possibilities of being in the present. His work can be found in over 100 public collections worldwide, including an unparalleled collection of nearly 900 works here at Colby, which we display throughout our building, but especially in the Paul J. Shuff wing for the works of Alex Katz, which opened here in 1996, and as Jackie mentioned, where Alex Katz Theater and Dance will be on view through February of next year. Alex, thank you for your advice and your collaboration on this exhibition. It brings our Colby family so much joy to celebrate these aspects of your work. My mom and Bubby would use the word nachis because it's familial joy, you know? And we're so happy to continue opening these stories about your contributions to and your impacts on so many artists and art forms and art worlds. Thank you. And so today, as we turn our attention to theater and dance, let's look at the first wall of our exhibition where we find a pretty good place to start our story. Right now we're looking at portraits of the dancer and choreographer Paul Taylor, as well as the poet and dance critic Edwin Denby. And Alex, I have a few questions for you to start. First, were you always interested in dance?
Mostly social dancing.
Yeah? I hear you were a pretty good dancer.
Thank you.
I also heard that you had a good dance partner in Ada. Is that true?
Ada's turned out to be the best social dancer I ever met. Yeah. I went to a high school where there was mostly dancing and clothes, and if you went to the same seat and didn't do anything, you could get an 80. No homework, and it was to go to Cooper Union. I had to go. I couldn't go bowling in the middle of the week anymore, or dancing. But they had the halftime Lindy, which is at that school, which I was interested in. Trying to do it and picking it up, and with the halftime Lindy, you could dance with people from Queens and people from Harlem and some people from Manhattan, and that's it. you couldn't dance with anyone else. Well, when I first danced with Ada, she followed, so I was thinking, oh, I must have gotten to Brooklyn College, you know. But 40 years later, I found out she figured it out on the spot. Mm-hmm. And it turned out that she's the best social dancer I ever met. She could dance with a kangaroo and make him look good.
That's fantastic. How did you meet Edwin, and how did you meet Paul?
Well, I met Paul through Edwin. I at the club, they showed a Rudy movie, and I thought it was fantastic. It was Sienna. He just shot the window and let you look at it for a while, and then shot something else, you know? And I never saw a movie like that, and that's what I would like to have made. And so I went over to him and tell him, I thought your movie's terrific. And then one day, one night, I went out, and it was Rudy with his dog. He's walking his dog. It seemed he lived just 4 or 5 blocks away. And so I asked him to come up, and he really liked my paintings and said, well, I'll do photos for you for nothing if you give me a little painting now and then. So that's where I met. And then I said, oh, I'm going dancing at the Palladium. Yeah. And the art world didn't go dancing at the Palladium. Mm. It was all Puerto Rican. And so I went to the Palladium, and Rudy brought this Edwin along, and these two guys just stood there. They didn't dance. And then Edwin started asking me questions about what they were doing, and I was telling him, well, the difference between the merengue, the cha-cha-cha, and the mambo. And then at the end, he passed himself off as a half-assed poet. That's what he said he did. And I didn't know he was this very famous dance critic till later. And so he said, why don't you come over? And Edwin lived in a loft, and Rudy had his dark room there. And I went over, and we hit it off, you know? And we're all on, somehow, we connected. And so I saw Edwin for the next 8 years almost every day. We had a lot of fun. And our backgrounds is completely different. So I could tell him that a pants leg should be eight inches from the floor with authority. I knew about clothes and fashion and things like that. And he took me to see a Paul Taylor dance. And I never saw anything like it. And it was, the athleticism was unreal. Yeah, because I hung out with a lot of athletes, and we all could do a one-legged knee bend, but it was tentative. And Paul knocked off 3 or 4 in a row. And so he was much stronger than all the athletes that I hung out with. And they're very smooth. So I said, I told Edwin, this stuff's very intellectual and very well done. And he said, what more do you want? And so I had to stop and think. And then Bob Rauschenberg was doing Edwin's sets, and there was a still life, and all of a sudden the still life got up, and the still life is Paul's back. And Paul said, I'm not dancing with the still life. And Bob says, how can you say no to such a good idea? And Paul said, easy. And that was the end. And he was going to Spoleto in 1 week. And Edwin said to Paul, I think Alex could do sets. And so I thought about it, and I did. And I did a set for Spoleto, and it was, they had a canted stage.
It was for a performance called Meridian.
Meridian, and that's the drawing I made. It was a canted stage, and I noticed that Rauschenberg never touched the floor. So I put the bright green on the floor and the blue in the sky and the dancers in pastel colors. I never got to see it, and I wanted it in white light, which were, they were all lighting in puddles, and they tend to light to make the figures three-dimensional, you know, from the sides, and I wanted it flat from the front. So it brings it more aggressive to, and it brings it like daylight, take it out of the theater. All modern dance was romantic and in dark places with puddles of light, you know. So it was a pretty radical move, and I was, I don't, the thing was that Rauschenberg was the best, and I'm trying to come over him. That was it, you know. And so, well, Paul, invited me to do another piece, and went over there, and it was this piece that you see here. And it was Bach and music, and it was kind of very interesting, because.
You think in a junction?
Yeah, I painted, well, I wanted to, in Cooper Union, Bach was made into a Cubist artist, and the work was in planes, and that's the way they explained it. And Paul was, now I think back, was Baroque, and a lot of circular energy, and I wanted the suits to extend the circular energy, you know? And by painting them on different, one side one color, one side the other, they rotated and expanded. And they put ribbons behind. We didn't have any money. So the ribbons were 1 yard apart. And that accelerated the Bach. And the whole thing was a revelation to me, because I had to think about Bach differently. And when I put the stop on the girl's legs, they didn't go up over the hip, you know. I just had the green. The girls were all upset. They said these things aren't sexy. And the thing with Paul is, anything I would do, he would try. He had so much ego. And then the girls got a lot of telephone calls, and everything was okay. And that's the story on that.
So, Michael and Alex, I was hoping we could just speak a bit more about these early works, not only Junction, but also Scudorama, and just to look ahead a little bit, The Red Room. How were these works received when you were taking these risks? And, you know, what
well,
were people saying?
Italy wasn't ready for modern dance. And I went there. We didn't have any money, but I went there, and I thought I'd spend about 3 days and go to Rome and take a look at it. It was the first time in Europe. I was 35. And the idea was to make a red room with the back is red, the two sides are red, and the floor is red. It's a red cube. And then the sticks, there were three rows of sticks, and they were acid colors. And then there were these discs, and the girls had things that were like flowers. Well, the problem was these Italian guys, stage sets guys, could make, they were doing a Rosen Cavalier, and they could make all these things in perspective with moldings, and very, very good. They're trained to do that, but to hang a disc that had to fly to put the cable to the disc. They had no idea how to do it. And it was a nightmare. And then the worst part of it was the designer, the guy who was in charge of the costumes, thought with costumes they have to be designed so they can move in time and space, and you have to make the crotch tight so the pants don't split. Really simple. You know? And to him, it was in bad taste to have a crotch tight, you know? And so he made the crotch loose and the pants split. And then my enjoyment of it was that he had 8 pliés. And I counted through the 8 pliés. Because if it split, he'd have to make another dance, which he would. And we got through the split. And then they had the thing of like, being in a red room, he had nothing to mark him when he leapt and turned. So he was doing triple turns on the apron of the stage. And he went down to the orchestra and said, if I fall in, push me back up. Paul was kind of, the thing, once in Paris later, and I ran into Paxton, a dancer, and Rauschenberg, and Paxton said, Paul's gone Broadway. And I said, if bells ring, I follow. And Rauschenberg said, you're right. And that's sort of it. Paul wanted to make make the dance real popular. He would risk anything. And I always thought that Paul didn't have such good taste. Good taste would have made him more conservative and wouldn't do the crazy stuff he did. Mm-hmm.
Michael, last night you and I were talking with Rob about the way that Paul understood the proscenium stage. And I was wondering if you could say a bit about that in some of these early performances.
So Paul Taylor, before he was a world-famous dancer and choreographer, he was a competitive swimmer. And he actually was at Syracuse University on a full swimming scholarship. But before that, he was a painter. And he started drawing and sketching when he was very, very young. And how Paul saw the proscenium was it as an actual frame. And I think that it's a very important lesson for me, specifically when Paul asked me to take over for him. He said, I want you to keep dancing, but I want you out in the house, and I want you to start watching my work. And the implication, I think, was that the frame of the theater is a frame. And when you're curating art, which I do, the art needs to complement the frame. So every theater I go to, every venue has a different texture, a different quality, a different nuance, a different energy. So I'm always looking at how Paul's work or new choreographic work complements the larger space. And there are works, particularly from this era, where the company was, I think by the 1960s, we're up to about 8 or 9 dancers. We're currently at 16. But these were smaller companies making work in smaller spaces. So what the scale of these works is in terms of bodies is fascinating historically. But what's also fascinating is Alex and Alex's designs of how the visual kind of rips open the space against these small ensembles. And it gives Alex's work leverage for me as a curator, because I can put them on large and small stages. They can be at Lincoln Center, and they can be in smaller, more vaudevillian-sized houses. The impact of the visual, in terms of color, in terms of depth, is a huge asset. So thank you for doing all of that.
Well, in the collaborations, when you get one working, it's much more energy than the painting. Mm-hmm. It's really out of sight if you get all three. And my attitude and Bob Rauschenberg's was, we're going for the tops, and if you don't make it, we're going to beat you. And Paul, and it was like we're not cocktail music.
Yeah.
Just talking about costumes a little bit, and you know, this exhibition features just really these gorgeous treasures, these costume and set designs, both from the Taylor Dance Company archives and also never before seen sketches from the Katz studio. Mm-hmm. I want to get back to the costumes themselves in a moment, but first I wanted to ask a question of Rob. And Rob, you know, you've had a chance to spend some time with these archival works and these parts of Alex's practice that people don't get to see so often. And I'm just wondering how you're feeling after getting to hang out with these objects for a while.
Lucky. No, I mean, I've looked at Alex's work for 50 years, pretty much. And there are parts of it that I knew well, parts of it that I knew less well, and so on and so forth. But to be able to deal with this part, which I did not know terribly well, and which tells me a lot about the other parts that I did know, is the key thing. He made cutouts as sculptures, as paintings, starting in the 70s, I guess it was. Actually, before that, he started in the 50s, he did it on plywood. But you know, he made them as independent works. But in the costume designs and these little silhouetted dolls, you know, paper doll things he did, that's kind of where it comes from, I think. And he understood that the shape of the body is both the shapes it makes in space, which is evolving and organic and round, and then flat shapes, mm-hmm. and his ability to conceive of a costume with somebody in it standing in front of a flat background and having that be the work, you know, that is really interesting. And you know, he talked earlier about social dancing. There's this huge painting which isn't actually a dance painting per se, which is in the last gallery, and it's over life-size portraits of people with their partners putting coats on and taking them off. But that is the choreography of urbanity, basically. It's like how people behave, what their manners are, and how all of those gestures and all of those ways in which people interact is choreography. So if you think that, you know, there's choreography happening just amongst us, if you think that there's choreography as shape against ground, flat, and so on and so forth, then you begin to understand how deeply connected all the things he does are to the way we see and think in everyday life. And Alex's work is always connected to everyday life, and I have over and over and over insisted that he's kind of the Manet of the 21st century or the 20th century, because he's the painter of modern life. You know, that's it.
Yeah. Mm. Yeah. Absolutely, no. I mean, Rob, you're talking about pas de deux, one of the, you know, staples and gems of our collection here, and you're right, it's never looked more at home, I think, than it does in this exhibition for those reasons. You know, there's a lot we can talk about. There are, you know, over two dozen shows covered in this exhibition, and I want to focus on some of the ways, Alex, not only that you were, you know, competing with other companies, but always you and Paul were competing with yourselves. You were always one-upping yourselves. You were always taking bolder gestures, making more daring statements, you know? And one example of this is the late 60s performance, Private Domain. I was hoping you could tell us a bit about it.
Well, Paul told Charlie Reinhart that Alex makes, we don't collaborate, Alex makes obstacles and I overcome them.
I work around them.
And that's true in a sense, but I give Paul a chance for greatness, is the way I looked at it.
Thank you.
He had an opportunity, and one of the things, the convention is, in the center of the stage, Paul jumps up and down, and it's a great hit, you know? And Paul jumping and turning makes all this choreography successful. You know, it's absolutely breathtaking. So I wanted to take away the center of the stage. That was, and when I started with it, you illuminate the center of the stage, make them do something else. And I got a loft on West Broadway, and across the street was a tenement. And in the tenement, they were the trials for the Sexual Olympics going on. And whatever you can dream of was there. In all the windows, they kept the windows open, and you saw 4 feet, and it could be any number. You didn't know what the sex was. And I could have a nude model, and it's much more interesting. You look at these feet and stuff through the window. And I thought, gee, that would make a nice set. So I said, well, why don't we put the set in front of the dancers and so they can peek in through the windows. So I made these apertures, I think 10 feet wide and 16 feet high, 3 of them. And resulting in the center stage, you could only see from the center. Mm-hmm. The sight lines were completely destroyed. And Paul, I understand, made 3 dances, choreographed 3 dances to overcome it. Mm-hmm. And so a person would jump in one of the windows and be caught in the next one. One man would be caught there. And you see pieces and parts of people. And we didn't know whether it would work at all until opening night. It was that hairy. And for the music, I wanted something post-Cage at that time. And we listened to stuff, and we found this Xenakis. It was he actually worked with Corbusier, and then Corbusier gave him credit, so he became a musician. And he was doing cerebral music, and it was the right, I looked at it superficially, at its style, and it was the right style. So we had it, and the people were dressed like that, and they were writhing in the stage, and it was, Jennifer Tifton lit it wonderfully. It was like under varnish. And he came all the way from Paris, went backstage and said, this isn't what I expected, and left. I think he was disappointed. But anyway, it was a successful piece, and yeah. You could sit in different seats. You saw a different dance, you know? And that's how it came about. And these things are like organic. You have some silly idea and you just work on it until it makes sense. That's what this was.
Here's another example of an erupting center stage. Mm-hmm. A 10-foot steel cube.
Yeah. Well, it seemed like having those planes, the cube was like planes. I thought it would give him a chance to do something different, and he did. He did one set of dances, and then they went through the same mm-hmm. thing twice, yep. a repetition, but it was completely different.
Yeah, so Paul Taylor commissioned Donald York, who became our longtime music director, to create a musical score where the first 11 minutes choreographically and the second 11 minutes are exactly the same. Nothing changes in terms of movement, in terms of lighting, in terms of music, and in terms of intention. Those are the only changes. And the cube remains this constant presence. There's a attraction, there's a little bit of a battle. What the cube represents changes just as much as the lighting and everything else. So it's a it's an incredibly dynamic work. And in the exhibit, I believe you're encouraged to walk in and around this ginormous cube. And as you're doing that today, imagine leaping and jumping and running through it. It's very, I still don't know how they do it. I understudied it, but I never actually had to perform.
You had some things, for part of it, they dance inside the cube.
Exclusively inside.
And they took their hand so you could feel the plane. And when the first person broke through the cube, it was like a shock.
It's like, yeah.
You couldn't believe it. It was like going through glass. Mm-hmm. And another thing about Paul looked at more things than anyone. And you'd find Assyrian moves, all kinds of art history moves in Paul's dancing. And a lot of art I have, like people touching each other, comes from Paul, you know?
Paul was very big on touch and gesture. It was a very, it was a primary impulse for choreography for him, was the intention that leads to a gesture. And we often say that everything is gestural. No matter if your leg is by your ear, it still comes from a gestural place.
I'll say one thing. They rehearse for 2 hours and get about a minute and a half, 2 minutes.
Yeah.
For the dance. Mm-hmm. You know? And Paul would correct people. And he was stronger than any guy. And when you take a 140-pound girl and turn her, nothing happened. You know, when another guy does it, a very strong guy, the muscles pop. But Paul was so strong, you couldn't see it. And then a girl would do a part, and Paul would say, "No, do it like this." And he made the girl look like a klutz. He could do a girl's part better than a girl.
He was incredible.
It was incredible.
Yeah.
It was totally unreal.
I mean, Michael, he asked dancers to do a lot, not just, you know, navigate enormous cubes, but sometimes to, right, dance
Diggity,
and leap over
yes.
30 cutout dogs, right?
Mm-hmm.
Where
did that idea
stage.
Come from? Huh? Where did that idea, the 35 dogs?
Damn if I know.
So in the Dance Diggity, Alex designed 35 steel cutout dogs and that are all over the entire stage. And this is an example in terms of scale where, depending on the size of the theater, sometimes we unfortunately have to let some dogs take the night off to create this obstacle course that is safe for the dancers to move. But in typical Paul fashion, even though there are that many steel objects on stage, the dance is incredibly athletic. There's lifting, there's throwing, there's partnering. It's Herculean that they accomplish the dance at all. And that's just Paul refusing to let an obstacle prevent him from choreographing excellence.
When Paul saw the thing, he was with Donald York, the composer, and the composer says, "Yes, I can see the dancers going through these very slowly. He's going to make music for that." And Paul says, "Forget it. They're going to go through it very fast."
It's a wonderful work. And we're actually going to be having it at Lincoln Center. We're bringing it to the 2022 season.
That's fantastic.
Yeah.
And if you don't make it to Lincoln Center in November, which I hope you do, you can visit with a couple of dogs downstairs.
Yeah, so we'll see. I think we can get all of them up there at Lincoln Center. But yeah, and they bite. They're very sharp. And sometimes they'll fall down. If a dancer lands too close to one very aggressively, sometimes the dog will just, and then we have to pick it back up.
So I want to leave time for our audience to ask some questions. But before I do, I want to end on another wall of our exhibition and ask you all, Rob, Alex, and Michael, to just, you know, share more with us about some of the connections between the discipline of dance and the discipline of painting that, you know, this show touches on, that helps us understand about Alex's work, but also more broadly. And Michael, you know, do it while looking at a picture yourself, right? Featured here is Michael Novak dancing with Paul Taylor alumna Jamie Ray Walker.
We posed for Alex, what was this? This was a year ago, I think. And Jamie Ray and I, and we danced together. We were very, very close friends, actually. And for us, in terms of working with Alex, it came back to gesture and this constant, like, pulling away, reaching, and coming back together. And it was this ebb and flow of departure and connection that you seem to like.
You guys are fantastic. They can go from one great gesture to another. Mind you, when they do a dance, it takes a whole afternoon to get a minute and a half or 2 minutes.
Yeah.
But this stuff, they just seem to flow from one to the other, and I photographed it, you know? And then made it into paintings.
Rob, how do you decide to hang a wall like this?
Well, I was going to jump in and say how I decided not to. But I would say, first of all, for the show as a whole, I mean, there are many ways to make an exhibition of this kind, which is in part archival or in part didactic or whatever you want to call it. You're showing material that is in itself interesting, but the way in which you show it can be incredibly dry, or it can be something else. And I decided that it would do a disservice to the dance and disservice to Alex to show it as just sort of a raw material. I said, why not play in the installation as they are playing in the dances and as Alex is playing in the painting of them? So the idea of stacking pictures like this is not a normal exhibition idea. And when I went to the Modern, I remember the sort of the going rule was that everything should be at 36 inches high, 56 inches high, which is eye level, and that things should be symmetrical, and the spaces between them should be even, and so on and so forth. Well, I got over that really quick. but I've also been looking for opportunities to do things I have not done in previous installations, and this one seemed to be the one, because basically what you've got is like a film camera cutting back and forth between the feet and the bodies. And then I also thought, well, this allows for other things, which is, supposing you move the camera from the dancers on the right down, you would normally find 4 feet, but you don't in this one, because they're being held up in space on this pivot, or on this, whatever you want to call it, on a pivot of 2 feet. And the other one is that the hips are not where they should be to go with the upper bodies. And so all of this is a way of saying, this is animation, these are bodies moving in space, and your eye is moving in space as well, and I cannot illustrate it, I can only sympathetically recreate it in another medium. And the medium in this case is installation. Mm-hmm. Because these paintings are not installational paintings, but they lend themselves to certain kinds of installational practices. Mm-hmm. So I figured, okay, the first show I did with Alex was at Yale. And it was a synoptic career retrospective that went from 1949 or so till the date of the show. And when he first saw it, and I did some things like this, and he didn't like it at all. And he let me know that. I mean, he frowned. He didn't say undo it. He just looked, nah. Anyway, and I think he thought it was mannered or what, I don't know what it was. But anyway, he didn't like it much. But then I think he sort of caught on as to what I was about. And when the feedback was good, he was assuaged. Okay, I decided I would just go a little bit further this time around and do it even more overtly and have more fun doing it. And I think actually it works. And if you don't agree with me, tell me about it. But you know, I do think that museum practice, so-called, is not any less inventive than any other thing one can do with visual images. Mm-hmm. And I think that curators are not artists as curators, but they can use some of the knowledge that they have as artists or as people who learn from artists to give a different view of material which may be already very familiar. In this case, it's not. But sometimes you can do it with material that is really familiar. So that was my tactic, mm-hmm. is to say, if I have this space, which is small, really, actually, this is a small gallery. I had to push out a little bit to get an extra room. But beyond that, it's just like, you can be really boring in a space this size, or you can be interesting. And so mm-hmm. I chose interesting, I hope.
Well, that show that he's talking about in Yale was a miracle. It's the ugliest place I've ever shown in. Oh. and he took really rough paintings that no one liked, and he scrambled them all over the place in post-minimal style, and it looked good. I couldn't believe it. So when he decided to do this show, I just relaxed. I said, I don't even have to go there till it's finished. I know it's going to be great. It's a great installation.
And it is, Rob. Thank you. So I think we have time for a couple of questions from our audience. I know that our staff members have a microphone, so if you wouldn't mind raising your hand, we'll bring a mic to you. Dun, dun, dun. Yes. Yes. Coming your way.
Not to give anybody a good flash by change of topic, but a while back at your exhibit, I was much taken by a series of line drawings illustrating Moby Dick, perhaps done while you were in training. They had wonderful motion, imagination. Could you have been contemplating going off in a totally different direction at that stage?
Again,
he was asking about the Moby Dick drawings, about their amazing line and motion, and he just wants to know more about the things you were contemplating when you were making those drawings, because he recently saw them here.
Oh, I just looked. I read the book. it was a second or third time, and they were they were like when I read it, they made those images. You know? It was just sort of really simple. That's what I saw when I read it.
Yeah, we have a question in the front row. Thank you so much, Paula.
I was curious if you've ever done any paintings of the social dancing that you were speaking
Anyone?
Of.
Anyone?
She was wondering.
Have you ever done any paintings of social dancing or do just full performance?
Do you paint social dance or just dance on stage?
Yeah, the social dance in the shows, Vincent and Vivian dancing.
Walk into our vestibule, you'll see a wonderful painting called Roof of Vincent and Vivian.
Can I just jump in?
Yeah.
I'd play a little art historian, art theorist, art whatever you are, and say that, you know, in the 1950s when Alex was starting out, the conversation was all about gesture and about bold, dramatic, felt gesture. And the tides were turning, the weather was changing in his generation. Now, here's a man who spent his entire life cooling down what was very heated up, but was also very, after a while, cliched. And the idea that you take an action and stop it, and paint it without demonstrating physically, obviously at least, that the painter is worked up over it, or is struggling, or is sweating blood, or whatever it may be. He was really going against the tide of his previous generation in ways that has never been properly credited. You know, and when people talk about the 50s, the cooling of the 50s, and there is talk about that. It's usually with reference to pop art and to overtly commercial stylings. But Alex was, again, an observational painter of life as it was happening. He was at the same time somebody who had not so much questions as answers to the issue of how the artist goes through the motions of making a painting and why the only tenor for it is not necessarily anguish or anger or passion or whatever it is, but why a certain kind of grace, a certain kind of measure, and a certain kind of cool is possible. And he was a fan of cool jazz, and is still, I think. I think I've seen discs in the studio. And, you know, that matters. So that if you have all the cliches that people have grown up with when they talk about art, and when they go from abstract expressionism, they go immediately to pop, and they're immediately to minimalism. There is so much else in American art beside those things, right? Mm. And I'm actually a fan of both those things, but I do not think that it's a straight highway from one to the other. Mm. I don't think that there is a necessity that in order to feel, you have to always feel at fever pitch. And I also think it's really important to think about these paintings as themselves performance. Now, there is a whole literature of performativity, performance art, blah, blah, blah. It's very academic. It's very tedious, I think, most of it. But the truth of the matter is that what Alex is doing is he is rehearsing in small formats paintings that he's going to make in large formats. And when he does that, he makes a different painting each time. But if you are a close observer of what he does, you can see him choosing how many marks are necessary to make this shape, how many colors are necessary or even possible to make this surface and make it cohere. He is planning as he paints spontaneously. He's planning a somewhat less spontaneous but fluid way to do it again and to increase the scale and so on. So that rather than being a sort of Vitruvian diagram, which is the way de Kooning thought about it, where, you know, the reach of the artist is the size of the painting, he is thinking of paintings that are vast. And he's painted paintings that are billboard size. He's painted billboards, you know. But if you want to get there, you have to get there in stages. And the idea that the artist actually designs or plans or moves, choreographs and prepares and then executes is completely against the ethic or the ethos of a certain kind of American romantic painting, and he has never been one of them. But he is, on the other hand, one of the artists who has sustained painting more obviously, more lastingly than the people who made a big fuss about it. So I came around to this slowly. Alex and I were not on the same wavelength when we met, but I came around to this slowly because I could see what he was doing. And anybody can. If you look at a painting and count how many marks there are, how many colors there are, what's the reach on this one? If it went like this to there, what makes that any less important than a gesture by Pollock that does the same? Nothing. And how do you hold a surface that's large, that's that large? You know, nobody has a lock on that. So if you think of great expanses of color as belonging to Barnett Newman or any number of other artists who've done it, supposing you did that another way. And I think that's what Alex has got on his mind and has had on his mind for these recent years, is to how to make a really big color painting with a minimum of marks, make it whole so it just doesn't go anywhere, so people don't, you know, think about what it should be, but what it is. So.
So we've just begun to open the tremendous objects and performances, you know, on view. But I think the thing that I'm taking away is that we can't just talk about them, we have to experience them.
Yes.
And so I'd like to recommend that we do three things. One is that we go down to the Chef Wing and enjoy the show. Two is that we check out a copy of the beautiful catalog that accompanies it. It is an archival treasure and experience on its own. And if you need help ordering a copy, please talk to me or Jackie or our front desk, and we'd be happy to assist you. And lastly, if you're planning a visit to New York this fall,
yes,
plan it for late October or early November,
mm-hmm,
when you'll have a chance to see Alex and Paul's collaborations brought to life, both on the Guggenheim Rotunda as part of Alex's retrospective there, and also as part of the Paul Taylor Dance Company's residency at Lincoln Center.
Yes.
And so with that, I want to invite you down to experience our show and to thank Alex and Michael and Rob for a brilliant conversation. Thank you all.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.